praise the Lord, let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord, let's just praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord. We're going to sing that one more time, and then we'll sing that one more time, and then we're going to sing it through again. You may be seated, and we're going to sing it prayerfully, and we're going to replace hands with heart and ask God to open our hearts to what He has for us this morning during the sermon. Okay? Let's just praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just lift and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts toward heaven and praise the Lord. Lord, we do praise you this morning. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this group of people, Lord, that has come out together. Lord, I pray your blessing upon the sermon, the words that I speak, Lord. Let them not be my words, but let them be yours. Speak through your word, Lord, to encourage us, to challenge us, to draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'll be seated. This morning we're going to pick up our study in the book of Hebrews. We sort of deviated there for a couple weeks through Easter. And if you would please get your Bible and turn to Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5. And I have all kinds of slides and so forth made for this sermon, but we're going to go a little bit different direction here this morning, and we're just going to use God's word, no slides. So you'll have to follow along in the Bible. But Hebrews chapter 5, and beginning with verse 1, goes like this. Every high priest is selected from among men and is appointed to represent them in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. Basically, the writer of Hebrews is going to establish, and he's going to begin to draw a comparison for us of reminding us how all of the priests were set up back in the Old Testament, and then he's going to show us how Christ fits all of those qualifications and is even a better high priest for us. And so, just like all of the high priests were selected from among men back when it was Aaron and his family as the high priests, so Jesus Christ was also a man. He came and was born and was selected. He was a man, so he fit that qualification. Verse 2 says that he is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. Talking about how good it was back in the Old Testament, the fact that the priests were not angelic beings, they were not gods, they were truly just men. And because they had the flesh and the weaknesses of the flesh, they were better able to be able to understand other men and other women because they had that humanness with them. And so we understand about Christ. And we've talked about that. The fact that Jesus Christ was tempted in every way as we are tempted, yet he was without sin. And so Jesus came and was wrapped in flesh, and that helped him better understand, better be able to relate to the things that we struggle with in our humanness. And so one of the things that I find very encouraging is that when we pray and we bring to the Lord, you know, our back pain, or we bring to the Lord a difficult situation that maybe we're going through, or whatever it is, Jesus is able to connect with and understand perfectly just exactly what we're experiencing, because in his humanness, he experienced it as well. He experienced those emotions, he experienced those feelings, and he dealt with the physical pain in his body. And so that's one of the things that makes Christ such a wonderful high priest, is his ability to connect with us because he spent those years wrapped in human flesh. And that's what the Bible is saying here, is that he's able to deal gently with us. And I like that, because sometimes I think we get this false picture of God in our minds, that he's standing up there with a holy 2x4, you know, just dying for a chance to hit us in the head, you know, and condemned, you know, and all the stuff that we do wrong. And that's not who Jesus Christ is. In fact, you know, one of the most popular verses in the scripture, John 3:16, you know, for God so loved the world and all of that. If you read the next verse, he says, look, I didn't send my son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. And so what I want us to understand this morning is, when we think of Jesus as our high priest, we really need to think of a loving, caring person who is there ready to minister grace to us. We need to think of one who cares deeply for us and who is ready to take us wherever we are, whatever the circumstances that we are in. We don't have to pretend. We don't have to try to fake it with him. We just simply come to him, as the song says, just as I am. And he loves us, and he cares for us, and he gives us grace, and he extends to us an opportunity to be saved. Picking up with verse 3, this is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins, as well as for the sins of the other people. Just talking about, you know, priests back in the lineage of Aaron. They were also men, and so part of their priestly duties, not only did they offer sacrifices for the sins of mankind, but they also offered sacrifices for their own sins, because they were human. We know that Jesus Christ did not sin. He lived a perfect life, and so he does not have to offer any sacrifices for his own sin. And so we can see that our priest, Jesus Christ, is so much better than the priests that they had back in the Old Testament. Verse 4, no one takes this honor upon himself. He must be called by God just as Aaron was. So Christ also did not take upon himself the glory of becoming a high priest. But God said to him, you are my son, today I have become your father. And he says in another place, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. And so we understand that God himself appointed Jesus as our high priest. God himself, it was his plan to send Jesus Christ in the flesh, to send him as a baby in a manger, so that he could offer himself on the cross to become the sacrifice for our sin. He would be buried and resurrected again, And now that he is ascended and seated at the right hand of the Father, that is why and how he is able to be our priest. That is why in our particular denomination, there's not a little booth over here with a curtain wrapped around it that you have to come in and speak to me as a man to confess your sin. There is nothing that teaches in Scripture that a man or a human being needs to mediate for you now. In other words, I don't need to be the one to tell, okay, Dennis, you have this request and this request, fine. Let me go to God for you. Okay, I'll go over here and I'll, oh God, please, you know, Dennis and this and that. Now, I can pray for you, but guess what? You can have that conversation directly with God. Why is that? Because we have Jesus Christ, who, as we pray, then Jesus himself is taking those prayers, taking those requests, and he is the one presenting them to God for us. So he is our high priest. Okay, we don't have to go to another human being. Now, is it right for us to pray for each other? Absolutely. And I would always encourage, you know, us to continue to pray for one another. Pray for our physical healings. Pray for the spiritual needs that we have. That's right. That's proper. But understand what this whole book of Hebrews is about, is teaching us that we don't need another human being to intercede on our behalf to God. Jesus Christ is our high priest. Amen. Verse 7 sort of begins to make a little bit of a transition here, and I appreciate these verses, so let's look at them. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Now, one thing that I always want us to be reminded of, that not only is Jesus the Son of God, and not only is Jesus now our high priest, but Jesus Christ is also always going to serve as our example. When I need to say, okay, so I'm a Christian, what should I do? How should I live now that I'm a Christian? What should that look like in my daily life? I can always look back to the example that Jesus Christ set for me when he lived as a man here on the earth. And so one thing that I know that I need to be doing very regularly is I need to be praying. I need to be desperately offering up my petitions to the one that I know can rescue me from my circumstances of life. I need to be offering up prayers and petitions, just like the Bible says that Jesus, during the days of his life, offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries. Let me ask you a question, and you don't have to raise your hand or answer it, but I want you to think about it. When is the last time that you found yourself in a time of prayer where you actually were shedding tears because the need was that urgent to you? When is the last time that maybe you were praying on behalf of asking God to break through one of your grown children's lives, or maybe you were coming to the Father on behalf of asking for someone who is just really struggling in life? And when is the last time that we prayed and had loud cries and tears? I mean, I can honestly say that I have prayed that way. I have begged God for the souls of my children. There have been things across my lifetime that I just was so desperate that I found myself you know, sobbing and kneeling and praying, and tears were not that I was trying to put on any kind of a show, not that I was trying to, you know, follow anybody that said, okay, now's the time to cry, but just that I was so overcome by the need that I was praying for that I found myself sobbing before the Lord. That's what Jesus did. And Jesus did that for us, not just in the garden. That wasn't the only time that Jesus prayed in such a way that he was in anguish. But Jesus, read your scriptures regularly in the Bible, it said, and Jesus went off to a quiet place and prayed. Early in the morning, Jesus went and was by himself and prayed. That's the reason that Jesus was able to live a successful, sinless life, is because he regularly found himself spending time having a conversation with his Father. I would want to encourage each and every one of you that the only way that we're ever going to be able to have a successful life here on this earth is to be in conversation with our God. In other words, the only time that some of us pray is when the pastor says, let's bow and pray. And I would encourage you to begin to establish your own prayer times. Take time to pray. I mean, at the very least, pray for your meals. And that's one of the things that we've always done as a family when we've gone out to a restaurant. You know, yeah, it feels a little awkward. I have to be honest. It's like, okay, you know, bow and pray. But we do that as a family when we're in a restaurant. We take time and we verbally, actually out loud, say words and ask God to bless the meal. Thank him for it and things like that. And then we spend time at home in various different ways, spending time in prayer. And I don't know about you, but a lot of the ways that I pray, I'm driving down the road with my eyes wide open, and I'm praying. Okay, so, you know, praying doesn't always look like, oh, Heavenly Father, thou great creator, you know. That's not necessarily always what prayer needs to look like. You know, I can be driving down the road and with my eyes wide open saying, Lord, you know that this visit that I'm going to be making in the hospital isn't going to be real, real pleasant. Please help me to be an encouragement. Or, Lord, you know, I really didn't want to have to work this long today, and I know that my family's at home and I'd rather be at home with them, but Lord, please bless them. Please be with them. Please send your spirit to encourage them. Or whatever it is that you're dealing with in life, do like Jesus did and spend time in conversation with the Father. Why were his prayers heard? Because of his reverent submission. If we don't get anything else from this set of scriptures, let's get that. I think that one of the things that I see across our country in our churches today, there is no more reverence. It's all about a party. It's all about entertaining each other. I mean, we might as well, in some of the churches across our country, you know, we might as well just show a video clip of Dancing with the Stars or something. You know, why were Jesus's prayers heard? And by the way, I'm not picking on you if you watch Dancing with the Stars. How many of you watch Dancing with the Stars? Especially when Heinze's on, huh? Okay, I've actually never seen it, but I know that it's one of the most popular shows that are out there. Okay, but the reverent submission that Jesus Christ demonstrated, I mean, he's God. He is part of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Yet when he prayed, he submitted his will to the will of God the Father. That's really how we should pray. Remember his prayer in the garden? Lord, not my will, but yours be done. So many times, and I'm guilty as charged of this, but so many times my prayers are all about my Santa Claus list. Lord, I want this, I want this, and before I, you know, get any older, I think I should have that, and I want that. And I'm basically kind of looking at God as some sort of a sugar daddy. Let's submit reverently to the will of the Heavenly Father. And where do we find that out? Right here in the Word. But that's why Jesus' prayers were heard. Verse 8 says, although he was a son, he learned... Wow. I got to stop right there and say, wait a second. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, learned? He what? He learned? I thought he was God. He was God. But he had wrapped around him the humanness that each and every one of us deal with. And the Bible says that he learned obedience from what he suffered. How did he learn? It was an ongoing demonstration of Jesus Christ's willingness to take every situation that he had to face in life and go to the Heavenly Father. And then based on what the Heavenly Father told him, he submitted to his will and he was able to get through life. That's a pretty good formula, by the way, for us to deal with the situations that life throws our way. We turn to the Lord in prayer and we say, Lord, I don't understand why I got laid off. It's not fair that I lost my job. I don't understand why this or that or the other thing happened. But I need you to walk through this with me. And he will. He is always faithful. You've seen the footprints in the sand. You know, my child, it was not that time that I left you. It was those times where I carried you. That's why you only see one set of footprints in the sand. We have a God that is faithful. He will never, ever leave us or forsake us. And the more we can learn to have conversation with him and to allow him and ask him to walk through these situations with us, the better he will help us to be able to deal with it. And then verse 9, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Now here is a basic truth, if you will, of our faith. A basic principle that we teach in Christianity. That there is not one sin that has escaped the ability for Jesus Christ to forgive. Did you hear? He became the source of salvation for everyone. What is God's will in terms of salvation? It is God's will that how many should be saved? All would be saved. So he is the source of salvation. In other words, salvation is available to all of us. Each and every one of us have the opportunity to turn to the Lord and to receive the gift of salvation. He is that source. Jesus Christ is the source. Every sin that ever was or ever has been committed, there is not any level of sin that overrides what Jesus Christ did on the cross. It is paid in full. It is sufficient. It is a done deal. But what does the scripture say? It says that he became the source of eternal salvation. But what's the catch? For all who what? Obey him. Now, some people read the book of Hebrews and believe that somehow now we've got to somehow work and earn our salvation. See, salvation is because of obedience. There it is. It's right there. What is the obedience that God is talking about here? The only obedience that we have to exercise in order to receive salvation is to obey God and receive the free gift of salvation that is offered through Jesus Christ. Jesus doesn't save you just because you're breathing. Hear that. Many people are led astray. Many people are under the assumption that all roads lead to the same place. It doesn't matter what road you're on. God is a loving God, and eventually we're all going to end up at the same place. How many of you ever heard people who say that? I know people who believe it. That's not true. It is true that God does love you. But it's also true that He is going to be the source of salvation only for you who have actually exercised your faith and been obedient to the scripture that says that we need to confess our sins and we need to receive Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. So there is a role for us to play here. Okay, the source of salvation for all who obey Him. And he was designated by God to be the high priest in the order of Melchizedek. And then this last couple verses, and we're going to end here, and this will make us a good place to pick it up next week. But let's allow this to kind of be one of those moments in time where we really hear the words of the scripture and step back a little bit and think about, is that me? Is that who I have become in my faith? And let me just read these to you. The writer says, we have much to say about this. In other words, talking about righteousness and talking about perfection and talking about, you know, moving on into the deeper things of the Lord and things like that. He says, we have much to say about this, but it is hard to explain because you are slow to learn. In fact, though, by this time, you ought to be teachers. You need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's Word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. You see, he's saying to this group of Hebrew Christians, this group of Hebrews, he's saying, look, man, there is so much that I want to explain to you about how to move on with your Christian life and how to experience the fullness of all of the things that God has for you. But he says, you're slow to learn, and some of the versions talk about you're dull of hearing. And literally what that means is, listen, you're lazy. You're hearing this stuff, but you're not doing anything with it. You're hearing it, but there's nothing to changing your life. It's like going in one ear and out the other. James said, don't be hearers of the word only, but be what? Doers of the word. It's kind of a lot like a government grant. You know, once the grant is given, if you don't use it, you what? You lose it. And so these people were basically mishandling what they were hearing. They were hearing truth. They were hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was going into their ears, but it wasn't showing up in their lives. Because they were still coming like a little baby needing to be bottle fed. And I know I've used the example before, but I'm going to pick on Rebecca. She'll be 14 at her next birthday. What would it look like to you if next week when we showed up for church, about halfway through the sermon, Rebecca would get up and come over and lay her head across Shelley's lap, and Shelley would get a baby bottle out of her purse and stick it in her mouth and begin to feed her? would say, now, there is a serious problem. Something about that picture just isn't right. Would you say that? I mean, that would be really weird, wouldn't it? That just would be like, okay, we got to talk. You know, this guy is something's wrong with this family here. That's what he's saying to the Hebrews. He's saying, listen, you guys have heard this stuff over and over and over again. He says in the next verse, he says, though by now you should, in fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's Word all over again. Hey, here's the call. Here's the call from God. Everyone who is a Christian is called to also be a teacher. Go ye into where? All of the world and do what? Make disciples, baptizing them. Listen, yeah, some people are gifted spiritually with the gift of teaching. That's true. But each and every one of us are called to take the truth that we have and let our lights shine. I mean, we sing the song, right? Girls, you can help. This little light of mine, what am I going to do? I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh, here we go. Hide it under a bush. Oh, no. I'm going to let it shine. That's what we're talking about. Listen, where are you at with your faith? Do you hear this, what he's saying to this group of people? He's saying, look, you've heard this stuff. You know it. Now, I've got people out there in the world that are dying. They're on their way to a real place called hell. You are my little light. Go out there and shine for me. Don't leave it all up to the pastor or the Sunday school teacher or the evangelist on the radio. Listen, you are all called to be light and salt in this dead and dying world. How's that going? How's that going for you? Anyone who lives on milk, verse 13, being still an infant, this is the reason, by the way, that these people were not getting it. That was not happening for these people. He said, anybody that still requires living on milk, they are not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. In other words, what do you mean I have to live holy? You mean there should be a difference in the way that I live my life? There should make, you know, this whole being a Christian thing should make me a new creature in Christ and I should actually live differently? Yeah. That's what the Bible says. And here it is. Here's the reason. But solid food, or the meat of the Word, if you will, the deeper understandings of the Bible, solid food is for the mature. And here it is. Here is the crux of it all right here. Who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Now, you know, and I'm not trying to brag, but if you would take my Bible and look at it, you would see yellow marks and you would see places where it's underlined. If I find it someday, I'll bring it in, my Grandpa Hammond's Bible. I think every verse is underlined at some point. I mean, the thing is wrapped in duct tape. It's held together by duct tape, literally, because he read his Bible through every year, and every morning he would get up and spend time. People, that's the key. And we're lazy. And I'm going to stand at the front of the line asking for God's forgiveness. Because I'm lazy too. I understand. It's just a whole lot easier to get the remote and go click and then spend the next 2 hours watching some mindless, pointless, whatever it is. We have no excuse to not be students of the Word of God. My encouragement to each of you would be to somehow, some way, and I've shown the Sunday school class when I was teaching, I mean, you can get right on the internet. Well, some of you can. Some of you who have dial-up can't. Oh, you can now? See, now no excuses. Okay, cool. So you can get, listen, right on the internet. You can go right on the internet. I'm not going to do that because that'll mess up. But you can go right on the internet to BibleGateway.com and you can select whatever passage of Scripture you want to select in whatever version. Gives you multiple versions to select it from. You can click on it and there it is. You can read it right there. Boom. Or you can click over on the audio Bible side of it and you can bring the Scripture up and then you can click on the button and Max McLean or one of the dudes will read it for you. I mean, it can't be any easier, folks. It can't be any simpler to read God's Word, to bring God's Word into your life. And I'm just here to tell you that like the Hebrew Christians, if we're not willing to do that, then we're really kidding ourselves. We're not going to progress and grow and mature and be the men and women of God that God wants us to be. So whatever it takes, you need to become committed to putting God's Word into your life. And I'm talking about more than just during a sermon. Okay, I'm talking about you in your own time, in your own way, picking up God's Word and reading it and studying it and asking Him to give you the understanding that you need. With that, I'm going to invite Shelley up. And we'll close with our closing hymn.
Let's stand.
Father, I pray that you will do that for all of us, Lord, that you will plant our feet upon higher ground, Lord. Take us to a new level spiritually. Lord, give us the desire to want to grow and mature, not in the wisdom of this world and not in the things of this life, but Lord, plant within us a desire to want to become more mature in our faith. Lord, not so that we can impress anybody or be all full of ourselves, but Lord, so that we can experience all that you have for us, not only in this life, but in the life to come. Lord, I pray that you will go with each one as we leave this place today. In Jesus' name, amen.